There we go. So the intention behind today's lecture was as much review and catch up as it was anything new here. My goal at the end of the day is to get everybody to the same point on being able to do all the homeworks and get all the stuff done. Let's see. I'm going to share my desktop here. And there we go. Can everybody see my slides?
Yep.
Excellent. So I'm going to go over Bootstrap and JavaScript, some more examples, and largely just try and run through all the things we've covered in a more explicit fashion and can answer homework questions. And by the time we get done today, hopefully everybody is ready to go write some good Bootstrap for this week's homework. Oops, that didn't advance my slide. That did, though. So Git and server commands are the first place we're going to start. And then I've got some new interesting Git commands for you. Then we'll talk a bit about variables, user input and output, a little bit about text processing, and a little bit about variable scope. We probably won't take up the whole 3 hours tonight unless folks have a lot of questions. But we'll just kind of go until everybody feels comfortable with the process and the stuff that's in here. So I'm going to snap back in and out of slides a lot tonight and just want to start on the Git side of things, of how I go about starting a new project. That's going to have me first jumping up to GitHub. And let's try not jumping up to other people's GitHub sites. Sorry. There we go. And apologies in advance, my computer is a little bit slow when I am actually recording sessions. So if there's a few pregnant pauses between loading things, that's why. And so I'm going to start a new project here. And I always call, I give the new project a name. So I'm going to call this one week 6 demo. Don't really care about a description here. But I'm always going to initialize it with a README. The reason that I do that is so that there's something to bring down when I am first cloning this directory rather than just cloning a blank directory. So I've got my new repo there, and it doesn't really have anything in it other than the README yet, but I'm going to go ahead and copy my clone path. And then I'm going to bounce over to my terminal window. Let me get out of where I was. And so this is where the terminal window would open to when I open it. That's my user directory. So I'm going to cd into untangling. Oh, I guess I have two U's. There we go, untangling. And now I'm going to clone that directory that I just created. So git clone, and then I'm going to paste in the clone path that was in there. And that's great. I'm going to week 6 demo. And I think on this one, then I'm going to jump into Visual Studio Code, and I'm going to create just the beginning framework of a web page in here for us.
Make sure that you don't take your over granted. Just get your...
Somebody unmuted. Is that for a question or just randomly? Catherine, I just muted you just to get rid of background noise. Feel free to unmute yourself if you'd like to ask any questions, though. So I've launched Visual Studio Code, and now I'm going to go ahead and create a new file. Let me call this week6.html. And in week6.html, I'm just going to create the basic framework of a web page here. So I'll give it a HTML tag. I'm also going to start putting in the doc type. This is because we have a couple of things to do today in regards to Bootstrap, and it really likes to see that there for some things. And so we'll put the doc type in. I'll go ahead and put a head in, and then I'll close that head. I'm not going to put anything in there right now, but I will in just a few minutes. And then I'll give it a body. And in the body, let me just give a heading here saying this is my new page and close that heading. And then I'll close my body. And then I'll close my HTML. So that's a decent basic HTML page. I'll save that, go to File, Save. And now back here in my week six demo, I'm gonna do a get status. I really only do this when I wanna see what's in there. I don't quite know where my debug log came from, but let's get rid of that. Oh yeah, something is creating a debug log for me. I wonder what that is. Well, okay, I'll ignore it. What I'm going to do, though, now instead of saying git add dot like I would normally have done, is just git add week6.html. This is a good reason for knowing that you can add those files individually instead of adding all the files at once. And it's because I don't want to add debug log, which I don't know what it is, to my repository. So now if I do a git status, we'll see that week six is about to be committed. Debug log is not. And so let me git commit minus m initial HTML. There we go. And I'll git push. So after it pushes up here, I will now be able to pop back over to my GitHub page and see that, sure enough, I have two commits. I've got the initial HTML and the initial commit. And that HTML should be the web page that I just had in there. Now, what I probably should have done at that point before actually pushing up and committing was to pop over to my week six demo and open up a new page and then drag my week six into it and just make sure that my page loads okay. Hello? There we go. This is my new page. So good enough. It does load okay. It's up on my repo, and so we're all good on that front. Let me pop back over to slides and see where I am on demos. We've just gone through editing in Visual Code, get cloning, get add, get commit, and get push. And then actually I ought to point out here that if I do go do a get status again, I'll see that debug log still isn't there, but that everything else is up to date with Origin Master. So the next place I'm going to go is up to the web server, and let's do that from a new Git Bash window, just so I keep one Git Bash open for my files and one Git Bash open for the web server. So one on my local machine and one remote machine, basically. And in this one, I'm going to go SSH dev 00 at cspubble.uvic.ca. And it's going to ask me for a password, which I have no idea of. And I'm going to do the horrible thing of going and pulling my whole password file with all my passwords open in front of you all on the recording. So nobody take any of the other passwords. And I'm just going to copy that password and then quickly put it back away and paste that in here. So that'll log me on, and I'll see that I'm in the root directory of this. If I do a present working directory, you'll see home dev 00. If I want to now, I can go into public HTML, which this is an important step, that everything you do should be inside that public HTML directory. That's so that it is showing up on the web page, that public HTML is the root of your web server's directories there. And so now that I'm in there, I'm going to do a git clone and go back to my web page here. and find that clone directory again. Oops. Let's go back to the demo. There we go. And I'll recopy that clone directory. And I'll paste that back in. So good deal. Now I ought to be able to not go on my local machine and see this as my new page, but instead go up to the web server, which again is cspubble.uvic.ca/dev00/, what did I call this? Called this week 6 demo. And week6.html. That's what I should have had in there. So that's the same page as I have on my local machine. One local, one remote. And so that should bring us through to the end of the web server pieces here that can connect by SSH, navigate the directories, everything goes under public HTML, and I can get clone to get it up there. Please feel free to stop me if anyone has questions on these pieces. Otherwise, I'm going to keep forging bravely ahead on demos, and then we'll come back and hit questions again afterwards. So now I want to make changes to the web page. I want to do a little bit more than I had in there. It's really easy right now because I still had the page open over here. So let me just add a couple more things into this. Let me add a paragraph tag and say, here is some more text. And close my paragraph tag. I don't want to come to this one yet. That was my web server. Instead, I'll come to this one, which is my local machine, and I'll do a get status again. And see how I've modified week6.html, but not stage it for commit. And so here's where I'll do a get add week 6, and then a get commit minus m, added new text, get push. That'll push it up there. So it now lives on the server, or on the GitHub server. It's not on this server yet, though. And so I'm going to cd into my week 6 demo directory, and I'm going to say git pull. There we go. We can see it pulled something down. And now we can see that both on my local machine here, see the file, see users, Derek JA. I refresh that and see my new text. And also on my server machine, when I refresh that, I see my new text. So that's the process of going ahead and editing and adding some changes back up to the server. Let's go through some more HTML at this point. This is just kind of a smaller subset of what you can find on some of these, and I'll navigate a bit and show you how to use them on some of the later ones. We talked about doc type HTML. This is an HTML5 decorator to say that it's an HTML document, and usually isn't that important, except now that we're working with Bootstrap some of the Bootstrap definitions require that to be there. HTML is the first tag in any of your web pages, then you've got a head, and then you've got a body. And so if we look at my web page here, so you've got the doc type in there, HTML, the head with nothing in the head right now, and then the body with a couple pieces of text in it. So let's add some things to the head. Let's first add a title. And to show you the difference here, notice that on my local machine, I've got too much stuff open to notice much. Let me drag my web pieces to a new window. Oh, come on. There we go. So you can see the title on these guys now, week6.html. That's just the default title. It'll grab the HTML page and throw it up there, or in this case, grab the whole URL and throw it up there. I want to give it something a little bit more interesting. And so here's where I'll, in the head, use my title tag. Okay, not that much more interesting. just something to differentiate it from the previous one up there. So I'll save it. I'll pop back over here. I'll hit refresh. And now week six demo for class shows up. So we can see the title tag is basically just giving the title at the top of the screen. Let's also throw in a couple of the other tags that we had in here. We were going to talk about link and script in here. And so here's a good time to create my week six CSS and to create my week six JS. So I can add JavaScript files and CSS files to this example as I go along. Right now, I don't have a whole lot in there, but let's at least put the stub for how to do that. And just because I'm a horrible at remembering things, I'm going to go ahead and go out to where I find a lot of this information and show you where I would find it if I don't remember the format of the link tag, or even that I need the link tag. So if I just search Google for add CSS to an HTML or anything like that, I'm going to get a variety of links up here. One of them is probably going to be the one from W3 Schools. And in fact, yeah, the first one here is the one from W3 Schools. I really like this website, in part just because it's very comprehensive and breaks things down into small enough chunks that you can go and actually use them. So I'm going to go down to the external style sheet, and there's my link tag. I've got the rel that says style sheet, a type for text CSS, and an href. And I'll just copy that and come back over and paste it over here. Now, of course, the CSS name is wrong, so let me go change that to week6.css. I'll save that. And of course, over here, that makes absolutely no difference because we haven't put anything in that CSS file yet. We'll come to that in just a minute. I'm also in a minute going to want to put in the JavaScript file. This one I do remember by hand, but you could go and look that up as well. I'm going to say script source equals, not ERC, SRC, equals week6.js. And then I need to close that script tag. And if I save that and come over here, once again, I'm not going to see any difference whatsoever, but that's okay. We'll know they're there and can use them here in just a minute. So that takes us through the things that we usually put in the head. Let me now use a few more things in here and create a little bit more full-featured page so we can see some of these work. And I'm not going to worry too much about the CSS or JS yet at this point. In just a few minutes, I'll go ahead and add those. I kind of like my heading here, so I'll leave my heading. But I'm going to put some of the other stuff into a div. And let me give this a div with a class of, first text. And if I start the div, I've got to stop the div somewhere before the end of the body. You can't have a div run over the end of the body. Here I'll close my div with another tag. Now, one of the things that I often like to do as I put new surrounding elements around is just to keep my tabs in order so that everything still looks right. And so I'll indent the paragraph tag there. Now, you're not going to see a huge difference in that, but it's in a minute when we start adding styling going to make a difference to have a div around things. The other thing you're not going to see a huge difference around is I'm going to start a new span here. A span is kind of like a div, but it doesn't do anything except for apply styling. And so if I give my span an ID of saying some ID, I'll put that around the word some just to be funny. And I'll save this off. And when I go to my page here, that's going to look just exactly like it did. I see no difference whatsoever. Now, of course, I can right-click view source, and in that case, I'll see that I've got a span, I've got a div. You can see all the stuff that's in there. So there is some difference. My new page has been updated. But as it is, I haven't actually seen the use of any of these tags yet because they're primarily for styling. We've looked at H1, we've looked at paragraph. Of course, I can put some more markers in here. Let's throw an H2. Oops, let's throw an H2. Here's a second heading. And an H3. Here's a third heading. And now, of course, these will change the page a little bit because we'll have some more headings in there. Let's add a button just for fun, a button and an image. Let me go find an image to put in there. Let's look for a picture of a giraffe. I like giraffes. That's a nice giraffe. I want to see if I can copy the image address and paste it in. It's kind of bad form to do this on sites that are getting very much traffic. And that's not actually a good thing to have in there at all. Let's go click through to that. Often Google will change the URL that's in there, and you actually just want the original URL, not Google's URL. And it's kind of bad form to do this on sites that are getting much traffic because National Geographic, in this case, pays for all the bandwidth charges where I'm linking it off of my site, and they're not actually getting anything in return for that. But Fox News has just bought National Geographic, I think, and so I don't mind wasting a little bit of their bandwidth money. So there we go. What I would do if I wanted to actually be legit about this, of course, is to use an image library and bring my own images down and then host them on my server so I could copy them into my server directly. And then it's a little bit faster and I don't depend on somebody else's images being there. But that's okay. For right now, let's just point to the National Geographic image up there. And so I'll add an image tag. And I believe that's just a source again. So I'll add that. And then I'll close my image tag. Let's pop over and make sure that worked. Oops, wrong one. It did not, which means I did something wrong. I'm just going to stay in here at this point, actually, and go to the image tag. And images. I bet it's an href, not a source. No, sure enough, it wanted the source there. Why did not my giraffe not show up? Well, maybe they aren't allowing that to be loaded from other pages. So let me try the other option. I really like that giraffe. So I'm going to save that giraffe down and put it into the folder where I've been working here. And just navigate down to that. Now, if I wanted to know what that folder was, of course, I would have just gone and in my command window here said present working directory, and that would have given me the whole path to that folder. I just happened to know that it was on the C drive under users, Derek Untangling, week 6 demo. And so let's go back now and change this to not be the full path to the graph, giraffe thumb, but just our giraffe thumb because it's now stored locally on our system like we want it to be. And so, yeah, that should be all right. close my view source. Oh, my giraffe was there all along. It was just too big for me to see. Okay. Well, let's fix that just a little bit. If I am back in my source here, let me give this some more information to tell it how big I want it to be. We look at images. We've got a few things that can allow me to do that. I'm going to, instead of doing this inline, these are called inline styles, and it's often much better to do that in the CSS file rather than styling it in the HTML file. And so let's just give this an ID. Let's call it giraffe. We'll save that off. And since I've already loaded my CSS, here's kind of jumping ahead of the game. I was going to do CSS in just a minute, but let's do a pound giraffe and say width 200 pixels. I'm just pulling things out of the air for this, and height 200 pixels. And we'll save that. And we'll see if that makes a more moderately sized giraffe. And yes, it does. So I hope that made a little bit of sense as to how to make that smaller and showed off the image tag just a little bit. Another thing that's often a good thing to do in here is to go ahead and give some alt text for that. This is particularly useful when targeting your website to people with disabilities, because that alt text is what screen readers read for blind users that can't actually see the picture. So I'm going to say a big giraffe. Incidentally, one of the things that alt text also lets you do is you can write browser plugins. So one of my favorite current Chrome browser plugins is Make America Kittens Again, that hides pictures of Donald Trump, replacing them with kittens. Alt text is useful for all sorts of things. So yeah, great. Let's go back and see what other tags we're talking about. We've had the button tag in there, but we haven't done anything with it yet. An image tag. Let's put an input and a link in here just to kind of finish off this this section. And I had not yet put a button in. Let's put a button in as well. Button, hello, closed button. I'm not going to do anything with this button yet. We'll come back to that in just a little bit, but we'll at least have it there to play with. And then we're going to put a link in on this. I'm going to go to end rather than putting a breakpoint there, so I'll remove my breakpoint. And then in here, let's just add a link to. Let's just send people to Google .com for a second. We'll replace that with more something more interesting in just a little bit. But I want an example of a link, and we can give it some text. Go to Google. So we'll save that off. We'll go back and look at the page again. There we go. Hello, and go to Google. Hello is not going to do anything. Go to Google. We'll actually go to Google. So I've done a whole bunch of stuff here at this point, I want to make sure that that gets caught. So I'm going to go ahead and do a get status and see what I've changed. I've modified week 6, and I've added a giraffe and CSS and JS files. I'm going to, at this point, try again to remove my debug log, because I don't want it there. No? Okay. I'm going to try and force it to remove my debug log. No, it doesn't want to get rid of that at all. Okay. So let me get add, and I'm going to add everything here. And then I'm going to get rid of that debug log. I have to remind myself, actually, how to do that. I often add the files individually, but I know you can. Let's see. It's not get remove, but get remove might pull it up. No, that deletes it all together. Is it get? Let's see about the get add options. I bet there is an option for get add. So just to kind of give you an idea of how I find these when I forget stuff like this. Options. Verbose, force, interactive, edit, ignore. Well, that didn't really do it for me. It'd be kind of silly if it were just a get subtract, but... I often find myself into Stack Overflow, and it is sometimes helpful and sometimes not so helpful. That time it's not so helpful. Stack Overflow is a site that you should know about, though. It is a site to go ask questions at, and you get a lot of traffic to it and a lot of people answering those questions, some at... varying degrees of expertise and utility. Somebody is typing very loudly. Well, okay. I'm going to just go ahead and let this be in there when we get to a later section of today's lecture. We'll actually remove that, and I'll show you how to get rid of it altogether as we talk about new Git commands. So there's going to be an extra debug log into this project for right now, but we won't worry about it. So I'm going to get commit, and I'm going to say added a giraffe and lots of stuff. And then I'll go up there, and I'll get push. No, I won't. Oh, push. I'll get push. And it will go up to my server. And at this point, because I have something kind of intermediate that I know I might kind of want, I'll go ahead and get pull again. Whoops. Come on. Shoot. So what you're seeing here is something that actually kind of bothers me about using the SSH directly from the shell as compared to from another SSH manager like my Kitty program. And that is that it times out. And so the connection was reset. What the SSH managers do for you is they actually allow you to send a timeout message. And I set mine to send every minute, which prevents it from timing out and closing like that. So I'm going to actually go to Kitty and open up my command window on the server from there rather than from where I was. And I'll CD back into public HTML, and I'll CD back into week 6 demo, and I'll get pull. See it, actually, before I go there, see it made a bunch of changes. It created a new giraffe, it created a new log, then made changes to each of the others. Well, except for the git, the week6.js. It added an empty file for that one. And let's go back to where I was over here. This is the page on my local machine. This is what it used to be. I'll refresh, and there it is again now with a useless hello and a link to go to Google. Oh, and I was going to add an input there, too. I forgot to add my my input. We're going to use that in just a minute, so let me go ahead and add that while I'm at it. Input, and we'll give this an ID equals all I don't know, my input, spelling that properly. And I'll close that. Incidentally, see what I did there by closing just at the end without, by putting a slash right before the close caret? One can do that in most cases, and it's called a self-closing tag. It doesn't actually match the full HTML5 spec, and so if you're running into problems with something, just turn it into an explicit close and see if that works any better. But as a short form, sometimes I just throw that in, and that's the one that doesn't have it in. That's the one that does have it in. I've got a text input box that I can put anything in, but I can't actually do anything with it yet because I haven't hooked that up yet. I'll wait to push that up until we get on to the next steps. So I think I've run over all of the HTML tags that I actually wanted to look at. Before we leave the HTML section, I just want to refresh that the W3 Schools is a great place to go for all the HTML stuff. And so I could have just as easily talked about lists or paragraphs or other elements, blocks, divs, iframes, all the stuff in there that you might want to know about how to format things. You'll find somewhere in here on W3 Schools. We've already looked at a little bit of the CSS. You can do it by tag, by class, or ID recall. And if in our CSS, you see that I used the pound giraffe, and so that is going by ID. That's the ID that I gave giraffe in this. I could have, since there was only one image tag on here, instead have gone to... let's get rid of our pound giraffe for a minute. We'll apply that to pound iraf, which doesn't match anything. And instead, what we'll here, actually, we'll do it this way. We'll put this on our image tag directly and save that. And we'll go back over and see that our giraffe is just exactly as we left our giraffe. If I now add one back for the giraffe, though, remember this was by ID pound giraffe, and I change just my width to 400 pixels. Let's double the width on that thing. And save that and refresh that. Oh, don't go home. My mouse bobbled. My mouse slowly bobbled. We've now got a very stretched giraffe. And to explain why that happened, we have to look back at the inheritance rules for CSS files, that because IMG, the tag, is less specific than the ID, this applies to all IMG tags. This applies only to the giraffe ID, because we gave an ID to a single thing in there. Then by precedence rules, the ID is going to take precedence over IMG and redefine the width, the 400 rather than 200. So that's just the way you can use these is to just treat those dependence rules. It also works by which CSS file was loaded last, but that also follows the precedence rules. To show that, let's actually do this for a minute. Let's add another link in here. And we'll call that week 6 extra, that CSS. And we'll save that and add a week 6 extra.css. And in that, let's do a couple things. Let's actually first look at it by giraffe and add a giraffe definition for a height 400 pixels. And we'll save that and we'll go refresh. And now we have a normal-looking giraffe that's 400 tall and 400 wide again. Let's, instead of that, turn this height back into a width of, width spelled properly, of 200 pixels. And we'll refresh this guy. And we'll see our draft go back to little, not stretched. Now, to explain why this is, let's look at the ordering of things that we had in here. We first loaded the week 6 CSS and then the week 6 extra CSS. If we'd done that in the opposite order, if we'd loaded the extra first and then we'd loaded the week after, and we reload this, then it's going to be stretched again. Because we had that 400 in there in the week 6. Let's look at one other thing before we leave that, because we do have the week 6 extra taking precedence over week 6 at this point. We'll get this guy back to that one. And let's go back to week 6 extra, and instead of doing this on giraffe, do this on IMG. So now that should take precedence over everything that is in week 6, but we're still going to see it stretched. And the reason for that is I'm redefining IMG, but I am not redefining giraffe. And giraffe takes precedence over IMG. So my redefinition of IMG, even though it was in a later file, does not affect the more specific giraffe that is being pulled up there. Hope that makes sense to everybody. Please stop me if some of these things do not. I hope I haven't lost everybody now. Oh, good. Yeah, looks like I still have folks. Excellent. So rolling on, the tags are hierarchical. That's what I just told you there. I have the class by ID. I didn't actually show class, but if you use a period rather than a pound, you'll have it by class. We've done that before. And by tag, and that's the order of precedence. Let's look at a little bit of the Flexbox stuff, just to have that in here as well while we're talking about CSS. To do that, let me actually add a few more things. Let me add the paragraph. I'll give that an ID of para 1. Let me add another button with an ID of button 1. I better say something on my button. My button seemed to like to say hello today. And then let's add a, I don't know, I'll just add another button with an ID of button 2. And this one better not say hello, so I'll say goodbye with that button. Okay, so just to save those and show that I have a page that uses them, I'll load that up. Here's some more text. Hi, goodbye. So using the standard rules for paragraphs and buttons aligning next to each other. But I want to override that in my CSS now. And wait a minute. I better check to make sure. Yes, my div does exist there. So I'll first modify my first text div, and this is by ID as well, so that's going to use a pound there, first text. And let's say display flex. And then let's say justify content, what was this? Space between, let's do space around. So that's going to evenly distribute them across the line. And let's go see what that does on its own. Not much. Okay. Why is that? See if we can put those at the start. No, we can't change those at all. All right. Is first text doing anything? I haven't yet popped into my development console, so let me do that right now, and we'll see if this is doing anything. And I'm going to bounce into first text. I'll select that. And that is actually not taking any of the styles. Display block. Taking WebKit display block. Let me go figure out why that is so. And I'll do this from over here as well. This is a Flexbox setting, which is a CSS piece. So let's go find Flexbox in the CSS examples. There we go, CSS3 Flexbox. All our browser stuff works. That should be on a Flex container. That should be fine. Display Flex. Yeah, okay. Wonder why the WebKit Flex was necessary in there. I've seen that before, but don't actually know the difference of that one. I bet I'm not targeting what I think I am with these, though. That's probably the most likely thing. Yeah, I'm totally not targeting what I think I am. With my first text here. Is still a block that is not seeing I did do that as a class, not an ID, didn't I? Oh, I did that as a class, not an ID. Okay, there we go. That's exactly my problem then. In here, I called that a class, so I need to target with a period, not a pound. And that's much more like what I expected to see in there. And you can see that WebKit Flex that I put in didn't actually do any good. It was just the display Flex that I needed. So I'm going to go ahead and take that WebKit Flex out of there. And save that. And it'll still look just fine. So basically what I've done with this one is with the Flex start, said cram all these guys as close as you can to the left-hand side, since this particular Flex container is starting at the left and working its way right. What I originally started out with in here was a space around, which should distribute them more evenly across that. There we go, perfectly. And so that, of course, is going to have the size of the button and everything else be relevant to the size of the text that's in it. And so directly aligning with those could be kind of difficult. Let me grab a few of the definitions of things inside that and see if I can help that. So I've got para 1, button 1, and button 2. And these are in IDs, not classes, so I'll use the pound for them. Let's do para 1 width. I don't know, 200 pixels. Is that going to cut things off? I don't know. It might. It probably will. Nope. Okay, cool. And let's just copy this guy and paste that in here twice, and we'll call that button 1 and button 2. And refresh this. There we go. So if I wanted everything even width, I would just give them explicit widths, and it would then space around evenly, put those across. Of course, if I wanted to make my button one squish up as much as I could against the paragraph, I could use the align self in on this and say flex start. And on the individual flex item, that would override what was going on. Align self, that did it to the top. I thought I had a, maybe it's justify self I want. I think it is. No, justify self doesn't exist. This might just be for up and down alignment changes as compared to the right left. That makes sense, actually, since that's within its container that handles the right-left adjustment. Scratch that one anyways. And we're back to the right size. Yeah, that's kind of okay right now on Flexbox. You can see it working. You can see stuff, some stuff in there. There's lots more to do with Flexbox, and it's not actually the system I use most. I use more Bootstrap than I do Flexbox these days, just because it's not quite as low level on it. But that's the basics of it. Let's look at some other CSS that we could put in here, just to have some more examples. Let's, on this first text section only, change the background color. And let's give it a blue, I like cornflower blue background. This will look corny. That's cornflower. There we go. A little bit darker than I want. Let me keep looking for different blues. Do a light sky blue there instead. Perfect, that's more like it. Let's change the color of the buttons to something else. And I'm gonna go with a different blue there. I'm gonna go with a dark blue on my button color. Why did my button color not change? Probably because that's just the color of the single line surrounding it. Let's change the background color of my button to that dark blue, and that should be the text of that rather than just the outline. There we go. That's appropriately horrible. I can't read my text at all. Let's change my text on that, and this is going to be an absolute atrocity of a design, of course. Let's do my text. No, that's text overflow. I want to do my text color into something lighter. I bet the text is going the same thing as the. Let's try changing our color on that. And we'll go white. There we go. Okay, great. So you can see that I'm changing colors around. I'm changing background colors. Let's make my text on that larger. To make it truly horrible, let's go with... they don't even let me put Comic Sans. Oh, good. I'm glad. I can't make it as horrible as I wanted to. And let's do a font size in here as well. Give that a font size of 14. Great. That was pretty close to what it was anyway. It's Oh, because this is a fixed width font, that actually might be changing that that for me. Let's pull out the monospace and stuff that I've gotten there and just do a straight courier. No, let's find another one. Let's do a cursive button so that nobody can even read it. Well, it's not that bad a cursive button. My font size doesn't actually seem to be doing quite as much as I had wanted it to be in there, which could be an artifact of the button, but could be something else going on here. One of the things that is often useful in this stuff is looking at examples of the kind of text that you want to see, and so that's something we could also do on this. I also use Bootstrap Studio, which I'll introduce a little bit later, which helps me map some of these things out just a little bit better. Text line center, text justify, text decoration, text transform, lowercase, spacing, height, direction, word spacing. No, it's not going to let me do any of that, is it? Okay, well, I don't actually care all that much. We could hunt that down and find that, but that had me with font family. Let's throw my font size on something other than a button, since I'm pretty sure it's the button that's doing this for me. Let's throw that onto the paragraph tag in there instead. And so we'll do a font family just to give that a different to give that a different one. And how about a nice Times New Roman? And a font size of 24. Oops, I didn't save that, did I? Do I need to declare that 24 pixels in there then? Or 24 points? Yeah, let's try 24 point font. That's more like it. So that's what I was missing on the other one as well, of course, is telling it what units to use. And I thought it defaulted to points, but apparently it did not. There we go. Okay, great. So font size is now working as one would expect it to on the button as well, on my now horrible, horrible, horrible colored button. Let's see, what else did we have to look at in here? Borders and margins. There's something that we haven't talked too much about yet. Let's find something in the headings, for instance, that we could change those to use some different borders. A border is basically going to put lines around what it is that you're working with. Margins are going to put padding or areas away from the edges of those borders. So let's put our second heading in a border here. That means I'm first of all going to have to go make sure my second heading has a class or an ID. And it does not. So let's give it an ID of head 2. And then we'll give that a head 2. And let's give that a border. And I don't remember the details of the border tags in CSS. So let's go look at that. Can do round borders or a bottom border or rounded or a blue border. Let's do a border style of a solid to have a solid border around this. That's probably okay. Let's do a 5 pixel solid border. So I better spell border correctly. Width 5 pixels. There we go. And let's give that margin now to offset where that yeah, that is. And so we'll call that a margin of 15 pixels. Okay, and so that set the whole thing in 15 pixels. See how it moved the border and everything else in there? If I wanted to move stuff inside, I would use padding. So let me do that as well padding left 30 pixels. Pop over here and refresh that. And boom, my stuff inside the border is now moves. So margin is going to move everything in the block. Padding is going to set some white space, in this case on the left, but I could have done a padding top or padding right as well in here, move things inside that. I think that's probably about all I wanted to talk about in terms of the CSS stuff in here. Let me go and now make sure that I have that saved. Oops, why am I not in there? Oh, because this was my old SSH window that it timed out on, and I should have actually just closed. Let's go find my proper local window. There we go. Okay, so I've got an untracked file and a couple modified files. So I'm going to add those. I'm going to git commit minus m lots of CSS. And I'll git push that. Then I'll pop over to my web server and I'll git pull that. Bring down lots of stuff, particularly changing the CSS file a whole bunch of times. And I'll now update and see my new gaudy stuff on that page. So let's do a little bit of Bootstrap stuff now. This takes us beyond the Flexbox stuff to stylings we don't have to work quite as hard at. I thought I did do tables right away. Okay, I did. Ignore the cover more tables in a bit. I decided to shove them in here with the rest of Bootstrap rather than revisiting Bootstrap. But let's first just go get our stylings and get the things we have to add to this page to make it work. So somewhere in here, we have our references. No, we don't there. There's actually a Bootstrap site that I really like for this initial stuff of getbootstrap.com. That has a really nice introduction to Bootstrap. So this is another good place to go aside from W3 schools. That tells us that we ought to also, to make sure it works on mobile, add this meta tag to the head. And so I'm going to do that just to make sure it all works properly. For the most part, that won't matter very much, but it's a good thing to have in there while I'm thinking about it. Doesn't really matter where on the head that I add that. And then we are going to, we'll talk about all that stuff in a minute. I just want to know where it's got my CDN link so I can just copy them. It must be on the getting started side, actually, then. There it is. Latest compiled and minified CSS. And the theme and the JavaScript. So I'll just throw those up in here as well. I'm actually going to put those ahead of my CSS. So if I want to override anything, it'll be able to do so. And I also, because this looks horrible, am going to select all these guys and tab them back into where they're supposed to be. Do that. Let's make sure I didn't break anything. I'm sorry, I'm having a really hard time hearing you, Lena.
I'm just wondering if it's normal to have that many links.
Oh, absolutely. There's not, this is a fairly small number. You'll basically put in the head as many things as you need for all the different stuff you use. In a little while, I'll be adding icon links and stuff to that as well. So it is quite common that your head get kind of messy. And you'll see that here's how you leave comments in here. If you're putting a lot of things in the head, it's really useful to make some comments about what you're putting in there and why. I need another one, actually. I need jQuery. I'm kind of surprised that it didn't tell me that. Well, that didn't do it for me. Let's go see why it didn't tell me that. There's the one I want. So I better take the whole script. That wouldn't have caused immediate problems, but I noticed when I was loading the page, since I had my dev console open, it gave me that error. And that's how I knew that I had forgotten to throw a jQuery in there. Get that evened up as well. Oh, but I just added jQuery. Oh, but of course I added jQuery underneath where it was needed. This is, again, that thing about needing to think about the order in which things were going in. jQuery was a dependency of Bootstrap in here. I need to add it before Bootstrap goes in. Excellent. Now my error is gone. So we've added the Bootstrap dependencies in here. That's including the dependencies. Let's look at some of the stylings we've already looked at. If I want this to appear in the big gray Jumbotron box, let's add that first. And so I'll just, in this heading, give... let me actually not do it in the heading. Let me actually do it in a div, because I'm going to want to add new stuff to it later. give this div a an ID or no, class rather of Jumbotron, and then I'll close that and get my indenting right in here. There we go. Well, that's kind of a horrible styling in there, but that's a place to start anyways. I may, inside my Jumbotron, want to give my H1 tag a new ID of, I don't know, first head. And if I wanted then to override anything Jumbotron was doing in there, I could do that in here. Font size 32 point is the main thing I wanted to do, was make my heading bigger. That didn't work. Why didn't that work? First head. Did I capitalize first head? Oh, I capitalized first head. Capitals are important. Well, that still didn't work. Why didn't that work? I'm going to grab my header. I don't see my ID on my header. Where'd my ID on my header go? Oh, I didn't save my ID on my header. That's more like it. Okay, great. So you can see I can apply stylings within the CSS stylings. My stylings take precedence over those stylings, and now it's put something in inside a Jumbotron. We did some of the buttons as well. So if on my buttons, let's... say that my button 2 here, my goodbye button, we're going to give that a class of button and button danger. Just because saying goodbye is dangerous. And so that will turn my button nice and red according to their definitions. So basically, I'm just calling Bootstrap stylings by stuff I'm already doing in the HTML and giving it the appropriate classes for Bootstrap. And the way you find out what those classes are is by going up and down the Bootstrap W3 school pages and learning all about what pieces you want to have in there. Let's, before we talk about panels and dropdowns and stuff, we could certainly add some of those. There are good things to have. Let's talk about tables, and that'll give us a better way of understanding where the Bootstrap positioning is coming from. So the grid system in Bootstrap is based on 12 columns, and it's responsive to screen size. Let's go read the little bit in that Git Bootstrap site that I had, and I want to show a few things through there. Let's find that, and it's in the CSS that I wanted to go. So CSS. So containers, that's the first thing I'm going to have in there. You've got two styles of containers in Bootstrap. The container will make it a fixed width container, and the fluid container fluid will make it span the entire width of the screen and wrap things around that way. So let me actually put a couple of things into a grid system, and then I'll show you the differences of those containers. Let's come back into here, and my stuff on the bottom that I'll put inside this. I didn't put a div around the stuff at the bottom. Oh, I should have. Let me put a div around the things that I've got down here. And put a tab there. tab there, and then I'll close my div. I definitely upload the dialog. That has all my formatting wrong. So there we go. Okay, so inside of this now, let's look at some of the containers to allow me to take these guys that are kind of just glommed together and space them more regularly across the page. And so on anything I have in here, the rows must be placed either within a container fixed width or a container fluid. And so I've got to give this div that I've put things into a fixed width or a fluid. For right now, let's add a class of container fluid. And then I'll show you fixed width in just a minute here. And then on the inside, that allows me to change the classes of some of these to something that will actually give me a container definition. And so let's look at some of the stacked container definitions. So ColoMD are classes for mobile devices and medium-sized mobile devices. There are a few steps smaller than this, but ColoMD is kind of your average small-sized screen. And because it's based on a 12-column layout, if I were to do ColoMD1, I can put 12 of them across the screen. ColoMD8 takes up two-thirds of my screen. So ColoMD8 and ColoMD4 spreads the first item across the first 8 and 4 across the last 4 of my 12 available columns. And this lets me put things where I want them in here, basically. So I'll use that in combination with my container fluid to think about where I'm actually putting things in here. And I'll give my button, the hello button at the start, .callMD, I don't know, let's give that 2. So I'm giving it 2 out of my 12 columns. I better get my other classes in while I'm thinking about it. Call MD, we want the draft to have lots of space because the draft is big. We'll give it 6 out of the 12 columns that we have. And we don't really need this guy to have very much. This is the href that we have in there. So we're up to 8 total. Let's give 2 and 2 to the input field in the href. We'll save that. And we'll bounce back over here. And that didn't do all that much, actually. It did bounce us over a little bit, but not the way that I'd really expected that to. So let's figure out why. We've got our container fluid. Let's just make a radical change here and make sure that we can break it by putting it across too many columns. Maybe it's because these are all already on too big a screen, so they can stack horizontally across. Because the ColoMD is actually for smaller size screens, and I'm on a pretty big screen here. that's probably actually what we're seeing in here. Let me go to one of the other definitions for screen sizes that that we have here. There's the extra small ones. I can do nested columns. That's not what I'm after. Column small, column medium. Collapse to start, horizontal above breakpoints above 970. So let's do these column large definitions because we're bigger than 970. Although now that I've shrunk it, I may not be. Okay. I am slightly puzzled, and let's go find a table sizing example to follow. Grid, grid medium. Oh, of course. I was applying these to the individual elements inside where I should have been applying them to the div that surrounded those and creating a row for it. Okay, so I need another div level that's going to handle that for me. And so in here, I'll give a div class equals row. And that means I need to close that div. And that means all my indenting here is wrong, but I'm going to change that again. I'm going to put the button in a div that has my class column large. And I'm going to actually do this the other way around just to be difficult. Of making the button take up most of the space here. So I better make sure I have my brackets correct. And then the rest of these guys, I'll throw in a div that is tiny, tiny, tiny. And I better make sure I have my div closing that. And it doesn't actually matter what I have as classes on the rest of, not on that one, it does, on the rest of these. And so for the sake of confusion, I will get rid of those. Since Bootstrap is not presumably doing anything with them anyway, since they're on items and not the divs. And then my formatting really confuses me in here, so I'm going to take everything in here and bump it in to make my indentations work properly. So I'll bump that in one, This is on the same level, but these are not. There, that works better for indentation. And let's save that and see if over here. That's more like it. Okay. So ugly, but I can see that my hello is sitting in the first one, and the rest of those are in a different size, and they flow. Not quite the table that I was after, but there we go. If we change those around, we ought to be able to make my button a little and everything else then big. No. Why is this? Container fluid, we've got a row. Got that closed. So that grid example makes sense. Following example will result in a 25-75 split on small devices and a 50-50 split on medium and large devices. Sorry, I've got a chat message here from someone. Oh, thank you. It may, in fact, Kristen, be because I had the dot in there. Good thing to check. No, apparently. Okay, so on small devices, we're doing 25-75, which means small of 3 and 9, and on medium devices, 6 and 6, to stack them. On extra small, we'll automatically stack 100%. And I have a div surrounding. Maybe that's what we should try in here, is let's say in large devices, which we should be now, we do it that way, in small devices, or medium devices, I guess, let's do it exactly evenly, so 6 and 6. And that should show us that when we are scrolling together, that we go to even. Well, it flows them properly, but that's not exactly what we were going for. I think I'm going to do some more work after we get off the call on this, and then send an example around to the Slack channel that shows how the columns work a little bit better. So I'll put these together and try not to live code it, but instead figure out what silly mistake I'm making, and then send that back around. Yeah, because watching you or having you watch my fumbling is not getting you anywhere on this one for me. So let's move on off of Bootstrap tables, and I'll also include in that example some panels and dropdowns Have it be a more complete Bootstrap example that I'll spend a bit more time on than we can spend here in the talk. Before we go on to JavaScript, I am a little bit concerned that I'll just ramble on through here with no feedback and not being aware of breaks and things, because we're on a call and all sitting in our comfortable homes. A break may seem less necessary, but let's do take just a couple of minutes. I want to get a drink, I'll be back. And give me a minute to get a drink. And Ricky, yes, absolutely. Yeah, this is being recorded, so I'll put it up with the slides like I have been in the past as well. Okay, I want to just remind myself where I am in the flow of this, because I feel like I'm moving a bit slower than I'd expected to be through some of these, probably because I just got hung up on Bootstrap. Yeah, I had just a little bit on JavaScript review here, a little bit on JS Fiddle, and then had a couple new things on Git user input, a variable scope, and then talking about homework. So I think we're probably over halfway through of what we're going on. We're going to finish well before nine anyways. But taking a little bit more time than I had anticipated on this stuff. Anybody have burning questions on what was on the first part? No? Okay. Well, I'll just keep rolling on then, and we'll talk about some of the JavaScript stuff. So we saw the script tag to include in the HTML page directly, or from the source from a different file. Let's just look in our ever-growing example at some of that. We had the script source week6.js, so that's calling it all from a different file. We could instead have just included within those script tags the JS as well and had that included in this file. I think I'm going to just leave it in the other file so we can have it all separated here for these examples today. Let's call a function from the HTML. So we're going to hook up one of our buttons. And let me just look at our page and see if our big mess of a page has some stuff we can make do something. Let's make pressing the high button make our first or second heading here say something different. That's something that we could do with this. So the first thing I'm going to do is figure out what different, and this second heading has an ID of head 2. And so let me jump over to the JS file, and I'll declare a new function that is, I don't know, change head 2. It's not going to take any parameters, and so I'll just do that with it. Let me go back and see that I did not capitalize head 2. Where's my head 2? Here it is. It is head 2, all lowercase. And so the first thing I'm going to do is declare a variable that is, I don't know, orange head 2, and set that equal to document.get element by ID. Head 2 inner HTML. And then I'm going to declare a variable that is new head 2, which I'm going to just call the original head 2 plus. Actually, I'm going to do this the other way around and add to the start of that and say new plus original head 2. And then I'm going to call my again document get element by ID. No, get element by ID head 2. Inner HTML equals new head 2. So that's not going to do anything yet, but at least I have a little JavaScript function in there to play with. And to get that hooked up, I'm going to get my hi button, I said, and put the on click handler here to be equal to. Something, but I forgot my function name, to change head 2. On click equals change head 2. And I'll save that. And then we'll come back over here, not to the one up on the web server, but to the one on my local machine and do a refresh to pick that up. Then I'll press hi. And each time I press hi, I get another new on my heading. Forever. So what we've seen here is we can call a function from HTML by using the onClick method on the button, for instance. From the JavaScript, we can get access to the inner HTML property of one of the elements and change its text. That's accessing the DOM to write back to the page, is what I call that. We've declared a couple of variables, and we've done a little bit with adding, we haven't done anything with subtracting yet, multiplying, and what we've been adding in this case are strings. Let's do that with numbers instead, which it will let us play with a couple little bit different things in here. So let's go take, I want to get that input field, my input in here. When I press the hello button down here, I want to do something different. So this hello button, let's give it an ID equal to add inputs. No, let's just not put spaces in our IDs, Derek. To add inputs, we're going to even more important. Never mind, it's not ID add inputs. We want to call add inputs when that is pushed. So that's on click, add inputs. So when this button is pressed, we're going to take my input, and we need to have somewhere for it to put that information. So let me create a new paragraph tag and give that an ID of total. And we don't need anything in it for the moment. Now I'm going to go write the add inputs function and get it to grab things from my input. So I'll make another function, add inputs. And the first thing I'm going to do in my function is I'm going to declare a variable. And let's get this variable to be the current total, which means I better actually have a current total in there. No, let's use this as a way of talking about ifs as well. So I'll add a variable current total is equal to document.get element by ID. Total enter HTML and then I'll say if cur total is not a number, let's figure out how to do this. JS if in a n. Or, there it was. Pull back to W3 schools for this one. This is in a n function to determine whether a function is not a number. So let's look at some of these examples. Is NaN 123 false? These are all numbers. If it's hello, that's not a number, so it's going to be true. This is not a number because it's got these slashes and stuff in it. Why is NaN blank not a number? I guess because that goes to zero is how we would interpret that. Because undefined goes to true, NaN goes to true, divide by zero goes to true. Okay, great. So what we're going to do in here is is NaN NaN cur total. And then we're going to say cur total equals zero. And why am I getting an error on that? Because I have to actually have this guy evaluate to something. So that ends up in brackets because that's how my if statement is structured. So all this is saying is that if it's not a number in there, if I've got something else in there that's not a valid number, to make that equal to zero. And since I'm adding the inputs, I'm going to go back and look here. That was my total. And now I want to take my input. And so I'll grab my input as another variable. And so this will be get element. I use that one a lot. And we called this one my, I don't remember if I capitalized that on that side. I think I did. This is an input element. So instead of enter HTML, we use value. Not any good reason why, except that it just kind of is. And then we'll actually do this same thing to get rid of not a numbers, since we're going to be adding in here getting. Well, no, we won't. I'm going to do something different with this one, actually. So what I'm then going to say, and I'll declare another variable of new total is equal to plus my input. And what this plus does is says treat the value of this as a number and not as a string. So it's a shortcut of a way of saying yeah, throw away anything that's not a numerical value out of that. And I'm going to add that to cur total. And then finally, I'm going to take this guy again. And set that back to new total. And we'll save that and see if anything I've done works. Where's my number? Really? Oh, because I didn't write anything in there. So let's say 5. We'll add our hello button. Where's this coming out? I thought I created a paragraph tag to hold that stuff. I did add a paragraph tag to hold that stuff. Why does my paragraph tag not want to show up? Huh. Let's pull my paragraph tag out of my table just so I have it somewhere else. Cannot read property value of null at add input 16. Okay. Let's actually, I want to make sure my paragraph's actually in there somewhere, so I'm going to give it an initial value of 0 for a second. Okay, I do have it here. Good. Okay, so JS16, I have obviously made some mistake. I thought my input was a value. Have I capitalized it properly? Oh, I capitalized it improperly. Okay. That's not exactly adding 0 plus 3 plus 2. Let's go look at why that is not exactly adding 0 plus 3 plus 2. It is still treating it as a string addition. So putting the my input before the current total. So let's make sure we treat the current total as a number 2 in here. That's more like it. Great. So as long as it knows all of these are numbers when it's doing this addition, instead of concatenating strings, it's going to be adding the numbers together. And so this is a way of doing the totaling like we were seeing in the problem from week 5 homework of adding up the values of the different toppings that were in there. And we talked about if statements. We haven't really talked about loops in here yet. We talked a bit about that last time. Let's take a different example. And I believe I actually had one concocted for that. Let me go see if I can find that other example. No, that's my string concatenation example. I don't want to quite do that yet. Well, actually, yes, I do. Let me remind myself where I actually am in this. This was onto new stuff, and I had some variables and user input discussion in the new stuff. Let's hold off on loops until we get to that discussion in just a second. And we'll talk about while loops at that point as well. So JS Fiddle, a bunch of folks have gotten confused around whether I want things submitted in JS Fiddle, whether they should be developing in JS Fiddle, or whether it is just something else to think about. By and large, you don't have to do anything in JS Fiddle if you don't want to. If you want to develop just as I've been doing here, that's totally fine, and I'm happy for you to do that. If you do want to use things in JS Fiddle, go ahead, but you'll have to copy them into your GitHub repository before you actually send that to me. Yeah. And let's see, what was I doing here? I was adding initial JS. So, the other thing that JS Fiddle is good for, though, is for asking for help. I've had a few of you in the Slack forum ask questions that didn't have code associated with it. It's really hard to diagnose anything without code associated with it. It's even kind of hard to, when you include a code snippet, diagnose things, because I can't actually see it run. And so an easy way of seeing stuff run is to paste it into JS Fiddle and then send a link to that JS Fiddle. And then I can modify it, and when you get it back, you know that you have something that also runs that you can then copy into your own files from there. It's really not the best place to do all of your development, though. In order to move things from a Fiddle into your own files, let's take this example we're going to talk about in just a second and move that into a file. So don't worry about what this example is doing yet. We'll talk about that in a minute. But let's say I wanted to create a new HTML file that had this stuff in it. I'm going to go and put it in the same repository that I already have stuff in and create a file for it. I'll call this strings.html because it's doing string manipulations. And then I'll come back over here I'll grab my HTML out of this and pull it over to strings. But my HTML isn't fully formed because JS Fiddle doesn't put a couple of things in. So let me put my doc type HTML in this and my HTML tag in this and my head tag in this, and then I'll close my head tag in here. And then at the end of all this, I'll throw my close HTML tag in. And I probably should go do some cleanup and make sure that my indentation is something close to correct. Yeah, that's close enough for right now. This is a little bit funny indentation-wise, but that's okay. It's going to bother me. If it's going to bother me, I'll fix it. Shift-Tab, by the way, always unindents things in here. And Tab indents them as a group like that. Okay, great. So I've got that piece in. Let's go back and the other thing I was doing here is something in JavaScript. So this one I want to actually be a body script. So I'm going to throw my script tag right here at the start of this. And I'll paste that in. And then I'll close my script tag. So rather than going to another file for this one, I'm just doing this in line. And I'll indent that a bit here too. One more, and I'll unindent this a couple times. And that needs one more indentation. No, two more indentations. Okay, so let's go and load that just to make sure that it is doing what we think it is. I'm gonna take this and copy it and open a new one and paste it. And I don't want week six. I want strings. And of course, unless I have that open, I don't know if it's doing anything. Yep. Okay, great. So we won't worry about what that just did, but we know that if we take the stuff from the fiddle here and copy it into the HTML, adding a couple extra items, the doc type, the head, the HTML tag, and then moving anything in a script into a script tag that we can get it to run just the same way it did in a fiddle. So that's kind of neat. It means that you can move things back and forth to a fiddle when you want to in order to post it up to the Slack channel to get help on it. That's about where I was with the review of things that we've already done. If there's any things that we've already done you want me to spend more time on before I launch into a couple of new things, stop me here. Okay. The new things I'm going to talk about are a couple more things about Git. I'm not going to talk about Bootstrap tables because that was horrifying, and I need to get that working before I talk about it more, apparently. Then I've got a couple new JavaScript topics in here. First, let's talk about new... whoops. First, let me not drop you. Sorry. You didn't see it because it was underneath the camera, but that was the most amazing catch with my knees falling off the edge of the chair for preventing a laptop going to the ground I've ever seen. Yikes. Let's see, where was I? Sorry. New Git commands. I've got a couple of things in here I want to show you about Git. As I've been going along today, I've been doing a lot of commits. This is actually kind of how I usually commit in Git. This lets me see a list of those things that I've been doing. The initial JavaScript, I added CSS, I added a giraffe and lots of stuff like that, new text. This just kind of goes backwards through my commit history shows me what I've been doing all the time. But it's a really ugly format spreads things out a lot. One of the things I like to do, actually, is I've got a more compressed format that I like to see my Git log in. This will become important here in a minute, for right now, let's look at that compressed history. It shows it much more tightly compacted. Instead of showing the entire commit string, it shows me just the early piece of the commit string there. And that's important when we come to do checkouts of earlier versions in just a minute. I don't want to have to type in that horrible pretty format and all those strings and stuff each time that I do it. I instead want to just be able to type git hist and have that come out. This is an area where I use aliases in GitHub. And so if I do a git config global, so it happens for all of my git repositories, this alias, and I want to make the alias hist, then whatever I type after that will be the git alias. And so I've already done this in git, it doesn't hurt anything to redo it, if I were to type this in just like that, it's going to set my my commit for history. And I think I had because I copied it off two lines, it put a carriage return in there, so that didn't work very well. Now git hist is going to give me the short form of all of the commit messages that were in there. And that allows me to track through what I've been doing in GitHub and when I was making commits. The next thing I want to talk about here if you're working as a group in GitHub, we want to look at... let's say the week six CSS file know who changed something. Git blame is the command we do for that. This goes through on a line by line basis and says both who, I've been the only one committing right now, so I get all the blame, but also what commit each change came up in. And so that means if something, I've located a bug down to a particular problem, let's say my image height and width are causing a problem, I can know what a commit that is associated with, this A3515. And I look back up here and find A3515. Oh, that's where I first added the giraffe. So maybe that's causing problems that I didn't fix when I put in lots of CSS changes. So git blame and git log, or particularly the modification of git log as git hist, are useful ways of presenting these. By the way, if you see in the first page what you want, you can always press Q to not go on through the later pages. And then finally, the git checkout command. And so let's do this a little bit differently. I had the initial JS in 2CF9, and just prior to that, I had lots of CSS changes. Let's look at my page as it exists right now. Oops, that's the wrong browser. So right now I have the JS stuff in here. You can particularly see that that zero was added only with the last commit. And so let me go do a checkout of the previous commit, which is this 292 commit here. And we'll go up at this level, git checkout, and then we'll paste that commit in. And what it's going to say is I'm in a detached head state. What that means is that I am no longer at the head of the branch. I'm earlier on the branch than I was. And so if I refresh, you'll see that it goes back to how I was at that commit. I don't have that zero and stuff in there. Because it's a detached head, I can make changes, but I can't actually check them back into the head without creating a new branch. And so here are the instructions for how to create a new branch. We'll talk about branching on the 22nd when we come back. Don't worry about branching, except to know that you can go backwards and look at things. And then when you want to go back to the way things were, you can do a git checkout master. And now I'm switched back to branch master, and I'm back to my head being attached, and I can go ahead and continue on. See, I'm back to here. Now, I could, if I wanted to, just take a single file and do a git checkout, let's say week6.js at, that. Oh, wait a minute. My path spec, is it git checkout at? I want it's not archive. I'll quit that. I really like this git how to site as well, by the way. I find myself back and forth to a reasonable amount. So that's checking everything out. If I want to just get an individual file out, that's not going to quite tell me what I want to do, though. I don't want to create tags yet. Oh, yeah. Okay. There we go. Reset or revert. Git checkout documentation. That's the main page, of course, for Git. So Git checkout, it's going to get the whole branch that way. I want to get a specific file out. There's the detach head discussion I was talking about. Here's one thing that I do wanted to point out about this. If I delete a file, checkout is how I get just that file back. Lets me recover if I make a mistake somewhere. Let me show that. I've got this working in my browser at the moment. I'm back up to the master state. If I were to just remove week6.html, oh no, horrible things have happened. I can't actually get this going anymore. If I get checkout week6.html, then it's just going to replace it for me. And so I no longer have to be afraid of deleting things if they're actually in the repository. I can simply check those files back out. But of course, that's doing it at the head version. What I wanted to do was check out an older version of just one file in here. I'm not actually reminding myself of what that syntax was in this. It probably doesn't matter. I can't actually think of why you want to do that right now. There we go. I thought it was. Maybe I can do that only at branches where I use the at notation that I was just trying. I guess it is kind of unusual that you bring a single file out of its branch structure. We'll talk about that a bit when we do branches next class, I think, though. I think that's probably going to be confusing more than illuminating on talking about branches right now. So that's Git. A couple more things in there that are kind of fun. Git's really a deep program. You can do a lot with it. And as you get more and more used to it, you'll get more and more impressed with it, I hope. Right now, it still probably feels kind of confusing, but it really saves your bacon a lot. If you're deleting things or moving things around to be able to restore to those known states and then check out older versions to see what it was you changed. Let's talk about variables a little bit. We have the input field. I got behind. There we go. We have the input that we used a minute ago. Text area is just kind of a bigger input block that lets you do multiple line inputs. I've only used the input for a single line in the stuff we've done today, and that's fine for all the stuff we're doing in the homework this week as well. But just know that there is a multiple line version called a text area that you can basically use as a mini editor in there. We talked a little bit about parsing numbers versus text. That plus was turning it into a number. That's a unary operator, it's called. That makes you interpret things as a number. And when we didn't have that, it concatenated the strings instead. The other thing I wanted to show was what was in that example, actually. And so we'll go back and look at strings.html. Excuse me. And that's how to split up a string. That's fine. So in this week's homework, I'm asking you to to process a common delimited list. And I'm going to show you in this form. So if I type in Sprite and root beer and process that, I'm going to see Sprite and root beer come off as individual items over here. In order to break them out of this string, I had to use the string split function. And so let's look at that. what I'm doing is I've got just list items here. These don't do anything in the program. This is just a header. I say type your drinks in the text box below with comma between each one. And then I've got an input with an ID of order, so I can talk to that in the JavaScript. And I've got a button with an onClick equal to order, so we know that that jumps to the function that's defined in the JavaScript. So within the order function, I'm first getting the contents of this order, the input ID order, and I'm putting that into my string. And then I'm creating a variable called order, which uses this myString.split function. And it's saying to split every time there's a comma and put each portion that is around a comma into its own array or its own element of the array order. So if we were to look at what is actually in order, let's do that. Let's say console.log order. And then come back over here and run that. Coke, Pepsi. We're going to see that I get an array back with Coke and Pepsi in it. And then because I'm going through this for loop to spit out everything that's in that array, then I'm getting a console log of the individual items as well. Now, one thing that you might notice is that if I do Coke, comma, space, space, Pepsi, and process the order, well, what I get in my array is Coke, comma, space, space, Pepsi. So it's not normalized, or it has spaces around it. So what I'm doing inside my for loop is using this trim function. And that trim function is another string function that simply takes off the spaces around any string. So these are the two essential commands, that your methods that you'll use on any string in order to split it apart in a comma delimited list, and then trim it to get rid of the spaces that are in it. And this will become important when we look at this week's homework. I want to talk a little bit about variable scoping in here as well. So variables are only accessed from within the block. What that means is that if they're defined in the file, then outside of any function, then they'll be available to all the functions within that file. If they're defined in a function, at the top of the function, they're accessible everywhere else within that function. In a for loop, if you declare a variable, it's only accessible within that for loop. And this is important because if you name a variable the same thing in different block scopings, you can hide that variable and think you're interacting with the global variable, but you're not. You're interacting with a newly defined local variable. And then when you leave that function or you leave that for loop, you think you've set the variable to what you want to use it at, but it's really not, and you end up with a program bug that's kind of hard to diagnose at times. And so let's look at this again in the JavaScript function that we were writing for week six. Because we're adding numbers there, create a variable start that is equal to 3. And then let's say in here, then cur total, if it's 0, let's not make it 0, let's make it start instead. If we go in there and hold on, something was changed. No, it got done. Go back to this. We'll load this back up. We'll give that a 3, and it previously would have set that to 3. Oh, it still set it to 3. What happened? Oh, because it started at 0. Never mind. Cur total to start wasn't the right place to do that. That would have worked the way I originally envisioned this, but when I set that to 0, rather than something that was not a number, then we never go into that not a number function. If I set that to something that doesn't resolve to a number, then we probably see this. it's XX. We say 3, we go to 6. So you understand why that went to 6? That because in here in the script, this is not a number, it then drops down to set the cur total to a number, and it's grabbing that number from start, which was defined outside the function. Now, if we were to say inside the function here that we have a variable start, which is equal to 10, and we run this, we'll go back to XX, which is not a number, and then we'll do that as a 2. And it was actually supposed to take that start. If I had done this properly. Oh, it wasn't overwritten in change head that I meant. It was overwritten in add inputs that I meant. Right. And so see here, this locally defined start is hiding the start that was block scoped to the entire file. And so scoping of variables is very important in that if I was trying to set start and then use start from my other function, I wouldn't see it equal to 10, I would see it equal to 3. Because as soon as I leave add inputs, this variable start simply goes away. So think a lot about variable scoping if you start seeing weird bugs and have used the same name in multiple places. Any questions on variable scoping? Okay. So let's talk about the homework. The homework for this week is to allow the user to type their items into the ordering page. So last week you created the ordering page that has buttons on it, so you press the buttons and it adds things to the order and updates a total for the price of all the items in the order. This week I want you to be able to do that by typing and using the split and trim functions. So let's go back to this as an example of that process. Say I was typing in pepperoni and mushrooms and olives and processing it, then I wanted to see mushrooms, pepperoni, and olives come up on the order that you're creating along with totaling the price of each of mushrooms, pepperonis, and olives, that updates the total. When I actually press submit order, I want to see a receipt for your pizza ordering application. So I want to see a list of all the toppings that were added, all of the prices that were added. This should be nicely formatted with columns for item, picture, and price. And then I also would like a subtotal field for the price of all the items, you to add tax on it, so 15% GST, and then calculate a total for all those items so they see what the final total for the pizza order is. And you can do that just on the page itself. That's fine. You could also use a Bootstrap popover class, but that's harder, and I don't expect you to do that. But if you do want to dig into Bootstrap just a little bit more, then that's the way to go on that. And, of course, to format it nicely with columns, this will probably require looking at that demo I'm going to send around of doing the Bootstrap columns. That's the easiest way to do it. You could use tables in HTML or Flex box ordering for those columns. But Bootstrap is going to be a more fun way to go on that anyways, even if not necessarily easier. This is a little bit larger homework that I've given in the past. I want you to think about some of the structure of your code as you do this. Since you add your items from two places, both buttons and text, it may now make sense to keep an array of items in the prices rather than just adding them in your functions individually like you have been. Because you'll have to call your functions from another JavaScript function if you just keep them blocked as individual functions like most people have been doing so far. Make sure you use split and trim and use two lowercase to make sure you don't get messed up by having uppercase entries in there. And do a little bit of error checking using things like that not a number function. make sure that there's actually something in your string before you're adding it. Error checking is good, and we'll talk more about error checking on the 22nd. If you've got some corner cases that generate errors, I'm not going to dock too many points for it this time. But do start thinking about how you validate user input as you do this particular homework. Are there questions on the homework? Okay. Are there questions in general? Do I still have anybody on the call? Aha! Uh-huh. I get chats. Excellent. So is the JS Fiddle in the slides? It should be. Let me go double check that. It is, in fact, that's the JS Fiddle that I was using in the slides. And I'm also going to send around, actually maybe I'll edit, no, I'll just send around in the Slack channel, actually, the repository I've been using for this example. So feel free to jump in and grab the files from there as well. Okay.
This was great. All class should be like this.
Oh, yeah, good. I got no feedback along the way, so I was hoping that it was coming through clearly and stuff.
No, it's great. And then that you recorded it too, so if we're a little lost, we can go back and actually watch the, you know, the parts where you're going over whatever confused us. It's nice to have the visualization along with it. Like, that really helps.
Excellent. Excellent. We'll have to try and figure out ways of integrating this into the way I normally do the classes then, because a lot of it I could do the same way.
I'm really excited that I can look at the recording later too to go back if I was a little fuzzy on some areas to go through it really slowly.
Fantastic, yeah. I also got a comment here about Project 2 work. I will be around during reading break by email, Slack. I'm also happy to do chats on Zoom individually and talking about your projects. Because there are a couple weeks till we meet again, please do keep thinking about your projects. That time's going to run out really quickly. So start jumping on that front end work and let me know if you need any help on it. Well, great. Thank you so much, guys.
No, thank you. This was great.
I hear somebody else. Oh, that's how I stop it. I stop my share. My last as to how to actually get out of here now.